I just wanted to say a few words of welcome and also add my voice to Bruce's spirit of congratulations to the people involved in putting this together. I think there's a lot of reporters here, a lot of colleagues, a lot of foreign correspondents. We've all been through a lot with colleagues over a long period of years in different settings, and I think we all know the obstacles to kind of spontaneous collaboration in our profession sometimes, whether they're institutional or they're just time and focus. And this is really rare, I think, in our experience, that a crisis has given rise to a kind of bottom-up response that has included some of the most important news organizations in the world, AP and Reuters in particular, and the Beeb and others that have done something a little bit outside of their own sort of lines by signing on to corporate responsibility principles early before others were establishing momentum. And I just want to recognize, if you look at the corporate responsibility movement in other industries, the first movers are the bravest ones and the ones that really set things in motion. And then on the civil society side, Charlie and David and others who, through their own volunteering and their own time and their own selflessness in figuring out what this should be, helped also to bring this forward. And so we're really proud just to provide the real estate and the food and soft drinks, and that's really, and now we want to see where this goes and help you in whatever way we can, because I think we all also recognize that, that journalism is in a period of deinstitutionalization, and certainly around this school, with all these wonderful young people who turn up against all of the conventional advice from some of their bosses and mentors, committed to a life in journalism, and the world they're going to go into requires them to navigate on their own to a greater degree than my generation had to do at a comparable age. And so it's a very important service of ours to try to help you help them have the resources and the training and the support they require to do the work that's so essential and that we've all been so motivated by over so many years. So, please, as a practical matter, if there's anything that we at Columbia can do to help in a more purposeful or more successful way than we're doing now, please let us know, because we really think this is important work, and most of all, we're really glad you're doing it. So, thank you.
Thanks, Steve. It is really an extraordinary thing for a school to kind of turn its resources over to convening a reform effort that it doesn't control and doesn't have any investment in beyond making the world a better place. Steve has been supportive of this since the beginning. Quick housekeeping, quick word on the structure of this evening. Housekeeping, the bathrooms, if you need them, are one flight downstairs. There are copies of the call for global standards of journalist safety, as well as the press release for this event, on the table in back, or Kelly, my colleague Kelly Boyce, is holding up her hand, she's got them. We are going to have two panels tonight. These guidelines that we're announcing draw on complex issues and lead in complex directions, and involve news executives, grassroots leaders in journalism, and many others. So we've got a big agenda and a short space to do it in. So we've got two panels. The first panel will introduce these new guidelines to all of you. It will be chaired by my friend Emma Daly, one of the great conflict correspondents of the last generation and currently with Human Rights Watch. It will include Vaughan Smith, who helped draft these, the three people who helped draft these guidelines. Vaughan Smith, founder of the Frontline Club and chair of Frontline Freelance Register in London. Charlie Sennott from Global Post and the Ground Truth Project. David Rohde from Reuters. And Marcus Mabry is the president of the Overseas Press Club. I am going to turn it, Rob's later. John. Sorry, and Don Daniszewski from the Associated Press. All central to the drafting of these guidelines. Emma, yours. Panelists.
Well, thank you, Bruce, and thank you all for coming. You know, as Steve touched on in his introduction, it's quite unusual to have a document or a group that involves some of the great media competitors of our time. We have Reuters and the AP together on this panel. Agence France-Presse is also part of this initiative. And this group brings together media organizations and the freelancers who work for them so often in dangerous places. So maybe just to start off, David, how did we get to this place? Why are we here?
Can everyone hear me just with this mic? Or?
Pick up the wireline.
Thank you, Emma. Before I start, I just want to take 1 minute to recognize a person who's here in the audience. Here in the front row in the red sweater is Diane Foley. She is here as representative of the newly founded James W. Foley Legacy Foundation. It's a foundation that has many things it wants to achieve, but one of its primary goals is to help freelancers get the resources and training and pay and support they need. So I just wanted to introduce Diane and thank her already for the work she's doing in this field. In terms of how this started, I'll try to keep it short. The initial thing was actually an invitation from John Daniszewski of AP to moderate a conversation. It was the foreign editors circle meeting. It was about 15 foreign editors at a joint AP managing editors and IPI meeting in Chicago in September. And that very same week, there was also, by chance, a meeting at Reuters hosted by my boss, Steve Adler, the editor-in-chief of Reuters. And the theme I want to point out is that those two efforts occurred on their own. And I want to say at the outset, there are other efforts. There's other responses by other organizations, news organizations, press advocacy groups, by freelancers themselves to deal with the safety crisis we face. In no way are these guidelines exclusively ours. In no way is this the only effort to help freelancers. And we have some initial signatories tonight. We're very proud of them and these organizations. But organizations, news organizations, freelancer advocacy groups, journalistic groups are absolutely welcome to sign on to these guidelines at any point. This is an open sort of living document, is a term Charlie likes to use. And if we haven't included anyone, we apologize. It was unintentional, and we're eager to include as many people as possible. Quickly, we had these two meetings in September that I mentioned, and there was talk of, well, what do we do? And eventually it came around to try to set up a sort of basic set of guidelines, a sort of rules of the road of how can freelancers and news organizations work together. After the first two meetings, Marcus, who's sitting next to me of the Overseas Press Club, hosted a meeting at the New York Times where we met again and formed a sort of drafting committee. It was all very informal and volunteer. And then later that afternoon, we actually came up to Columbia. Bruce was there and met in Steve Call's office, and we're off to the races. Vaughan Smith from the Frontline Freelance Register was actually also there in October. And you know, we started a process, and I'll be honest, a process that most of us thought would never work. And it's an absolute miracle from our perspective that we're here today. And I just thank everyone that's made this happen from all these different organizations. And thank you all for coming tonight.
And Charlie from Ground Truth Project, formerly of Global Post and a founder of Global Post. Do you want to jump in as well on,
sure,
on this?
I think the question was, where did this all start? Is that my post? Can you hear me? Is that good? Good? So I would just say, I think for everyone in this room, and I know on this panel, the starting point depends completely on how many friends you've lost in the field. It could have started with Rory Peck, it could have started with Marie Colvin, Tim Hetherington, Anthony Shadid, and all of those people are friends of these panelists. And so I think the starting point's been this long process of seeing a lot of friends and colleagues, so many of them being local journalists from Iraq, from Afghanistan, from places where we work, and we've really gotten to know them, but in a really deeply emotional way. I think this process really hit a turning point when we lost Jim Foley. Jim was working with Global Post. He was an incredible talent. Nicole worked with him in the field. A lot of you may have known him, or you certainly know his story. He had the spirit of what we call ground truth, and what is really about, you know, like the importance of being there. And the way it went down with Jim's first capture and then murder, to me it was a global turning point. And sometimes you need these events to really begin to turn your heart or turn your mind toward what we need to do. And I think it woke us all up that the peril is rising so greatly out in the field for journalists that we need to coordinate and confront that peril. And the most extraordinary thing about the last few months has been the way we've seen these organizations coordinate. Everyone has been so quick to collaborate and to discuss and to try to really think this through and to try to really find out how do we set these standards. So I think a lot of that, from my own point of view, has to do with Jim's spirit. Diane, Jim was amazing. He was such a team builder. He was such a person of like a warm heart. And I think his spirit is all like through this process about, you know, we're gonna really work together, we're gonna try to do the best we can because we love this work and it's really important work and it's getting more and more dangerous out there. And as news organizations rely more and more on freelancers, we're gonna have to bind together in a community that cares about this and think it through together in a way that we really hold tight. And I think that's the origin.
And thank you. And in the spirit of Jim, who would have asked the question. Yes. So we now have 25 signatories, including a number of major media organizations. The document is full of a lot of shoulds. We should do this, freelancers should do that, the news organizations should do this. So does that mean that the AP and other signatories will do these things, or is it, you know, more of a, we hope to be able to at some point in the future?
Well, we view these as a group of standards and principles that we are trying to abide by already at AP. Some of the underlying values are, if you send someone out on an assignment, you're responsible for that person, whether that person is a local journalist, an international freelancer, or a full staff member. We have tried very hard to provide training, medical evacuation, body armor for anyone who goes in the way of danger to bring back the news that we all need. So we see these as ideals that we have a responsibility within our own organization to implement and to live by. And we realize that by writing it down on paper, we're saying we think these are the best practices, and others may hold us accountable. But first, we would hold ourselves accountable.
I want to pick up on a couple of things in there, but I also want Vaughan to bring you in because you're really the voice of the freelancer on this panel, and it's quite unusual to have both the news organizations and the freelancers committing to this. So, you know, do you feel happy with what you've got? Is this, you know, is this going to make a real difference in the lives of freelancers, do you think?
I think the process, I think this process is extremely exciting. I think that we've got this far for several reasons. And remember, we've been talking about these things for decades. I think the key thing in this instance, or one of the very key things, is that there's proper freelance participation and representation in this process, and there has never been before. And I think that completely transforms it. And I hope that from now on we won't be talking about freelancers without talking with freelancers, because we haven't done it before. And I think that's a very good thing. So I think that's certainly going to help us. But can I just pick up on the point you mentioned, Emma, about Seven, the wonderful photographic agency, have raised this point about there are quite a lot of shoulds in it. Now, my view and the FFR view has been that, and we have not got everything we wanted out of this process. It's been a negotiation. We've been negotiating for freelancers. That's nearly 50% of the negotiation. as one organization, we've been doing all of that. And all the other media organizations have had adding their little bit in, and we tried to maintain enough in there for freelancers for it to be worth us to sign. And we took the view collectively, I'm part of a board of seven freelancers, and we all decided, it was unanimous, that we should sign this. And we are concerned about the shoulds. There's a hair's breadth of difference between us and seven, and we completely respect their position on this. They are right. Should is too weak. We would like that changed in time. However, it's still a good agreement. It's still important because, actually, should is a word that you can hold people to account to, perhaps not as much as will, but it's still a useful word.
And Marcus, just following up on the freelance issue, I mean, John talked about people on assignment, and a lot of the document talks about freelancers on assignment, but of course that's not, you know, the only or even possibly the most common way in which freelancers work for media organizations. Does this, are these guidelines going to help, do you think, those situations where there isn't such a close-knit relationship, or is it really more important to focus on ensuring that the freelancers who do have a already a strong working relationship actually get the benefits extended to staff?
Those are the most important questions, I think. It's really important to hold two perhaps seemingly contradictory thoughts in mind about these guidelines and the process that we went through, the very hard process we went through to make them happen, to come to fruition. The first thought you have to keep in mind, and everyone's hit on this, and Vaughan talked about it, is this has never, ever happened before. Never before have news organizations, journalism advocacy groups, come together and said, here are a set of principles of how the relationship should go between freelancers and news organizations. That's never happened. We're in a vastly transformed and constantly transforming industry in foreign news coverage. More of it is done by freelancers than ever before. The future probably lies in that direction still, even more. And increasingly, and this is something we hashed out a lot in the formulation of this document, by local journalists who are not Western freelancers, and what protections do they get, which we don't address at length in here. That was one of our big points of contention we talked about. So this is unprecedented and extraordinary. At the same time, this is only a beginning. This is just the first. This is the start of a process, not just a sort of a document and signatories. And there'll be more signatories and many more who are, as Vaughan was saying, a hair's breadth away from signing on now. We will see more signatories. And even more important than the signatories, though, to this document, is the fact that there is a set of documents, there's a set of principles that are now public, that all of us, whatever the news organization, whatever our status as a freelancer or a staffer, can point to and say, hey, have you read the principles? Whatever, even if you're on contract, if you're just a 25-year-old who's wandering through Somalia, who calls up some people and say, you know, I got some stuff, you want to, you know, there is something you can all point to now. And I think that that beginning of that process is even more important than this historic process itself. The fact that we will keep talking to one another and we will deepen and strengthen that network and that understanding, which has never ever been public before.
Yeah, I wanted to add to your original question of how this came about. Well, of course, it was born from tragedy, as David and Charlie said. But there was also, when we looked at the landscape of who's out there working now, we see it's not always long-established organizations like AP, Reuters, and AFP. There's a lot of new entrants to the international news coverage field, new digital sites, new groups of journalists, and we thought that by sketching out some principles or rules of the road, it would help move all of these new players and move the established players to some kind of common understanding of what ought to be done.
Good.
Oh, well, I was just going to actually ask you, Charlie, to talk a little bit about how the landscape of threat has changed. I mean, today we had Reporters Without Borders put out their annual Press Freedom Index showing declining figures, perhaps not surprisingly. We've had a brutal year. And of course, 2015 didn't start off so well either. Do you want to talk us through a little bit how the landscape's changed for both freelancers and international freelancers and the local journalists upon whom so many reporters rely?
Sure. And I would just to pick up on the last points too, I think there's a real value to a moral commitment that's embedded in this document that's the start of that process. And I always say, as David pointed out, this is a living, breathing document. We want your input. Everyone in this room, we want you to get part of this process. It's going to be stronger by the more people who come into this. And I think that's going to be critical. To answer your question, how has the landscape changed? I think we all know this, and this is a group that would understand this, but very quickly and very broadly, I would say the threat has changed because of two major forces in our lives. And I think one is the internet has changed the dynamic between journalists in the field and the people we cover. And the other big force in our lives, sadly, is terrorism, and is the threat that is very different than the way we've covered conflicts in the past. And I think when I covered, or all of us here at all these experiences, when we've all gone across checkpoints to talk to Hezbollah, or you crossed a checkpoint in Northern Ireland in Belfast to talk to someone who was representing the IRA, when you did that with the confidence they needed you. You were a messenger, you went across the line, and they needed you because they, whether you liked their methods and what they were all about didn't matter, because they had an aspiration that was changing the landscape you were covering, and therefore you needed to get at that, and they would share it with you because they wanted that message out. Then you would go safely back across that checkpoint, and you'd go back and you'd do your work. That's over. I think these organizations now have the web, they put the word out themselves, they don't need the messenger, and the relationship between messenger and organization you're covering has completely changed. You're putting yourself in great peril if you try to go get a comment from these guys. And I think we all know that, it's very obvious, but it's a really big part of the change. And I think the other big change are the organizations themselves. I mean, what could be more an embodiment of the darkness of the time we live in than ISIS? And this is barbaric. This is beyond even anything we could have imagined 5-10 years ago. The cruelty they've shown, and I think it's a new landscape of peril that changes the calculus with everything. I think the other thing the internet has had a big impact on is the business, the models of how we're going to pay for good journalism in the field. The web has disrupted those models. Again, we all know this, but it's disrupted it in a way that big newspapers like the one I worked for many years, Boston Globe, no longer have foreign coverage. I was their foreign correspondent for more than a decade. It was a great job. I loved it. Part of starting Global Post for me was because that was dying out. Those big, great newspapers, Philadelphia Inquirer, LA Times, Baltimore Sun, Chicago Tribune, Boston Globe, they all folded their foreign bureaus. That's how Global Post started. And we started with a confederacy of freelancers who wanted to still go out and do that work. But that now has taken on a sort of much more sweeping, I would say, and dramatic change to the industry, where now freelancers are increasingly what we rely on. And so internet's had these two very different but very related changes, and this document intends to confront that head on and find ways to deal with the peril and the fact that many of the people facing that peril will be freelancers. And as you pointed out, Marcus, local journalists who for way too long we haven't been sure we have real codes and moral responsibilities. Everyone who's worked in the field may have had their own individual one, or worked for a good news organization that made sure people were taken care of. And every news organization here has done that. But we all need to be reminded of how important they are. So that's the purpose of the document.
Okay, so there are two things I'm going to pick up. But first of all, Vaughan, one of the things that the document tries to do is also to talk about the responsibilities of freelancers. Can you talk a little bit about that? What freelance the Frontline Freelance Registry members, for instance, have committed to by signing this document, and what those practices actually mean?
If we go to answer this, I'm going to go back to the beginning of this whole process. FFR, the Frontline Freelance Register, has its own documentation of this stuff and had it before. We have already written a code of practice. which we think is the best one, by the way, because it's ours, but also because it includes, it goes much further than this one. This document, it's important to understand, deals with about half, in terms of types, of freelance activity. There's a whole area, which is a really complex area, of on-spec work, where this document does not touch on, and will be much more challenging to deal with. Quite a few people in the industry don't even realize the extent of what freelancers do, because their organizations have particular relationships with freelancers. They don't realize that other organizations have different ones. And part of the problem with a gathering like this is you end up with the people who've helped make this work are invariably the more, you know, amongst the more responsible of the people from the industry that we end up dealing with. And they often don't realize what the rest of the industry is really up to. What I really want to talk about, and forgive me for not answering your question, is what I want to talk about what we didn't get in this document, because it's important. The one thing we didn't get in that we wanted was the fact that we'd like to be paid as freelancers within a given reasonable period of time. The truth of the matter is, even large responsible organizations can pay freelancers after 100 days or maybe 200. And you often have a situation where freelancers are having to stump up their own costs, and they don't get paid that for months as well. So one of the issues we have as freelancers, and it's something that people do not talk about, the industry doesn't talk about it enough, and we would like to keep talking about it because it needs resolution, is pay. We are mostly paid abominably for the work we do. And it isn't right, it isn't acceptable. There's a massive moral argument here, and I would like, you know, every decent journalist to know what their organization is actually paying the freelancers that it engages, because I think they'd be horrified if they knew. I'd also like to pop in, if I could, the fact that I've just heard on my computer thing that The Guardian have just signed up as well, which is rather good news. So we've got the BBC and The Guardian from Britain, which I think is pretty good so far, and there are lots more that we're going to get as well. What was your question? I might try and answer it.
No, it was about what freelancers are committing to do as well.
Oh, yes, because that is important. Well, look, ultimately, those commitments that are in the document are very similar to the ones that we insist that anybody who signs up to our register. And the register is a term I think people aren't quite as familiar with over here as in Britain. It's simply a list. It's a list of people. It's not really a union, but it is a representative body, and we've got 500 members, which is very significant. I think what people don't understand about freelancers is we mentor each other. We work together. We can talk to each other rather more easily than the industry can talk to itself, oddly. It's just part of our makeup. And in a sense, we're not afraid of having to do things professionally. At FFR, to become a member of FFR, you have to declare yourself as professional. It's very much part of the process. You have to subscribe to a set of ethics and a code of practice, as I've described. And this stuff's included in that. It's basic professional behavior. And as a professional workforce, we'd like professional pay.
But you should talk about freelancers who might not want to sign on either.
Yes, look, we're touching on Sennott. I tried to use it on Sennott, and I have great respect for any freelancer. I think they should publicly declare if they disagree with it. It's very important. We do not represent all freelancers. We represent those freelancers on the register. I think it is important that you know, we've signed this just. We didn't get everything we wanted out of it.
But, I mean, it's important to say that you know, it does ask freelancers to take appropriate training, particularly in difficult, dangerous environments. It does mention pay. It does remind news organizations that preparing yourself properly to go into a dangerous or difficult place is expensive, and that should be reflected in pay levels.
One has to remember that what's really happened here, if one stands back from this, is there are a lot of good people in this industry who care about the welfare of freelancers, and they genuinely do, and they want to see that improved. But the problem is, you can't want us to do stuff when we're being paid so poorly. Because the fact that what we as an organization want to achieve is we want people to realize that poor pay is our biggest safety and welfare problem. Safety problem. If you don't get paid properly, you can't afford the safety. You can't afford the equipment. You can't afford the courses. And in the past, we've got some of this stuff through charitable means, and we've been very grateful. And we wouldn't want that to stop. But what we don't want is to still be receiving charity instead of a fair wage in 5 years' time or 10 years' time. Because we have been getting it back. That's what's been happening for the last 25, which is how long I've been doing it.
Can I just follow on that for a sec? I would say, you know, we all know, David is from Reuters, we know what Reuters is, Marcus, New York Times, we know the New York Times, John's AP, we know AP, and you've been introduced to Vaughan, and I, truth be told, I am also on the board of trustees for Frontline. I believe deeply in Vaughan's mission, I believe deeply in the freelance registry. But I wanted to share with you just for a minute about, I think Ground Truth has this position in between being an advocate for freelancers, as Vaughan is, very strongly and convincingly, and being a publishing organization. I just for 1 minute, I want to share it because particularly for those of you who are students and who might be out in the world, I think it could be instructive to know that the Ground Truth Project, it takes its name from this document. The Ground Truth Field Guide was written in 2008 when I co-founded Global Post. And the Ground Truth Field Guide was an intention from day one of Global Post to share standards and practices, and to really try to codify that in our community. Jim Foley had a lot of great training. Jim Foley had first aid training. Jim Foley had hostile environment training. But I do think there were a lot of lessons we need to learn about going forward that we can do better, and I know we can. So that's why I started the Ground Truth Project, and what we do there is try to train and mentor the next generation of foreign correspondents. By giving them resources they need to do big projects, things that they might not get to do as a freelancer, doing sort of one-off, quick hits, hustling, as Vaughan has pointed out, for too little pay. How could we create a funding pool to do some aspirational work, to really reach, really try to get you to do this kind of work, and then to be surrounded by mentors and people who will teach you to do it safely, and give you the kind of editing and the kind of, I don't know, just practical experience of people who've been in these places before. So I just want to put that out because we've decided in our field guide to now put the call, as I call it, this is a really poorly named document, a call to global safety standards and principles. I don't know where our headline writers were, but definitely it's a mouthful. And I think I'm just calling it the call. And we put the call embedded into this document, and we're putting it up online today. You can get it at thegroundtruthproject.org, and it's really a place just where you can download, first of all, the principles, of course, but also just sort of our own sense of guidelines. And I also want to say we do essays about lessons learned in the field. David Rohde wrote a beautiful one, really important essay about kidnap and ransom and a need for a rationalized policy. Gary Knight of 7Photo, who's our visual editor, wrote a really important essay about freelancing and defending it fiercely, by the way, defending the freedom of it and the independence of it. And James Foley wrote an essay that is amazing. Before he went to Syria, he sat down with me on the train to Tim Hetherington's funeral. And he sat and wrote out the lessons he learned when he was captured in Libya first and then released. And I think equally importantly, he shared his passion for why he wants to do this work and why he wants to be there. So I really want to encourage you to check this document out. I think there's a lot this community that's interested in this can learn from it. And it's totally all yours. If you want to use it, use it. It's free and it's out there, and we want you to engage with it.
Well, and those resources will be available. One of the things that this group is trying to do is actually gather the resources that are available for freelancers and put them in one place. But David, you wanted to follow
just on a quick, there is a sort of separate effort that's coming out of the guidelines to create a network of organizations to support freelancers. So, you know, there's a great program run by Reporters Without Borders that provides insurance. There's some great safety training by Rory Peck. The Dart Center offers, you know, counseling. Can, you know, those organizations work together, kind of rationalize their efforts to create a network that will help freelancers get, you know, the support and training they need, and Vaughan can keep working on pay.
And that's the big focus of the next panel, right?
But I would also add to that the Journalists in Distress Network, because I don't want to lose sight completely of the fact that this also speaks to local journalists. Mm-hmm. And the most threats around the world actually are directed at local journalists, not necessarily in conflict areas, but because of the work they do. So I want to make sure that we don't forget that.
And in the same, I also want to make sure we remember that that network, and the next panel will talk about it, also it's for the industry. Whether you're established, like our news organizations, or whether you're a new player, in you know, now you have foreign correspondents sending you dispatches from the field, and you've never had that before, and you know anything about that, but you do it, it's for all of us, because we need to understand best practices too. And as the industry evolves and grows, and we, in these new organizations, employ more freelancers who are increasingly younger and without experience, we all need to understand the best practice here. We all have to help one another. It will always be adversarial to some extent, I think, whenever you're talking, this is just, you know, my old Marxist, you know, theories. When you're talking about, you know, those who have the means and those who are, you know, providing the work. But it doesn't have to be as adversarial as it has been, and we all have to deal in this new world together. And none of us will survive in it if we do not deal with it together.
John, I'm going to give you the last word.
I think in putting together these standards and principles, none of us were naive or thought they would solve all the problems. And as you've heard, even some people who were wonderfully prepared and experienced suffered and were killed. And but our hope is to move the needle a little bit in the direction of what Vaughan mentioned, professionalization and a little bit in the direction of what we all believe in, which is making a better partnership among news organizations, journalist organizations, advocacy groups, to be mindful of the dangers and to be mindful before the work is done of what steps we can take to minimize the danger.
Well, thank you all for participating, and I want to encourage you to stay for the next panel, which will go into more detail about the different aspects of the guidelines. So thank you.
Thank you. Second panel, make your way up. We'll take questions. We'll have a conversation, really, with all of you after the second panel. We just want to have a lot of people and wanted to move the conversation along. While other folks come up, I just wanted to make a couple of points. First of all, I would urge you, all of you, to read these documents, the call through, and really note the extraordinary responsibilities that have been embraced by the freelance community and by news organizations alike. You know, this call says that all journalists need to have the basic skills to care for themselves, to seek adequate medical insurance, to understand, to be up to date on standards of care and safety, both physical and psychological. Gone are the days when people should just go out in the field and see what happens. We need to take some responsibility for ourselves. And by the same token, the standards that this call raises, the bar that it raises for industry, is really quite significant. Training, insurance, adequate compensation, all the different issues that you heard addressed in the other panel. I also wanted to just suggest something to you about purpose before I introduce the panel. What we are seeing, what we have seen in the deaths of James Foley and Kenji Goto and Stephen Sotloff and so many others, what we are seeing in the assassinations of local journalists around the world, both freelance and employed, really is a race to the bottom in press freedom. And it's only through efforts like this, identifying particular constituencies and taking concrete action instead of simply hand-wringing, concrete action to raise the floor, that we really raise the floor on all journalists' rights. This is actually, I believe, a central freedom of the press project. It's not just about the relatively small number of international conflict freelancers or the somewhat larger number, significantly larger number of freelance journalists who live permanently in crisis areas. This conversation tonight is about all of that. Panel, let me just introduce the panel, first of all, from left to right. Nicole Tung, who who is a independent photojournalist, freelancer, and also on the board of Frontline Freelance Register. Rob Mahoney, who is the deputy director of the Committee to Protect Journalists, one of the great champions for all of us in this room and beyond. My Columbia colleague, Judith Matloff, who is a distinguished freelance crisis correspondent, who's worked everywhere from Mexico to Moscow, and also leads here at the school one of the various efforts around the world to address freelance safety, a four-day crisis reporting preparation course for freelancers, about which brief ad, there's a flyer on the back along with the call and along with the press release for this event. And Steve Adler, who is the editor-in-chief of Reuters. What we have here is the full spectrum of the changing media landscape, from news executives in more than century-old companies to freelancers to folks involved in nonprofit advocacy who now have moved in new directions because of changing developments in the world. This is a wide-ranging effort. Steve, I'm going to start with you. I was pleasantly surprised with the alacrity and speed with which Reuters, like the AP, signed on to these principles. I will confess that when we were having these conversations in our little drafters group, I kept saying, let's get individuals, don't bother with the big news organizations, the lawyers are going to be all over this. What led Reuters to move so decisively to support these standards, and what challenges are they going to bring for your company?
I wish I had a better answer, but the answer really is the guidelines are so similar to our pre-existing internal guidelines that it didn't really require us to do anything radically differently. So there were a few things in the draft, I think I'll hold this, of the guidelines that we had issues with, but what ultimately resulted is actually virtually identical to our internal guidelines. In our internal guidelines, which we don't share publicly but are for our staff, but the preamble is the physical and emotional well-being of a full-time stringer is as important to Reuters as the physical and emotional well-being of a staff journalist. And then it goes through all the things we do, through hostile environment training, through going through the whole process of providing safety equipment, providing insurance, all the things we do for our staff journalists, we would do for journalists with whom we have a relationship. And that, you know, the fact is we've got several hundred journalists who are not on staff, who are in places like Syria and Iraq and Libya and all over the world, who are not on staff, but for various reasons are spending, you know, a pretty significant amount of time working with us. And we're committed to providing the same protections to them that we provide to our staffers. Sometimes it's more complicated. So for example, because most of our freelancers are local journalists, if you're in a place, and again, for safety reasons, I won't name the place, but if you're in a place where you can't actually go in to the place safely to provide hostile environment training, we actually go to enormous expense and difficulty to get them out of the country to provide hostile environment training someplace else. So we were very comfortable with these, you know, very strongly supportive of them, and also believe it's a really good sign that all these organizations want to work together to do this.
But let me push you gently, or maybe not so gently. A freelance photographer I know emailed today and said, sounds great, but really these are going to, in a practical sense, do more to make editors and executives on the desk feel better than they will to, in any practical way, change the relationship between freelancers and employers. How do you see the relationship evolving, and where do guidelines like this fit in?
Well, I think the relationship is evolving, at least for us, towards taking full responsibility for freelancers. And the fact is, if a freelancer who we're working with any kind of regularity, something bad happens to them, as a news organization, you kind of have to make a choice. And so you learn about this over time. So you learn that, you know, realistically, it's not helpful or useful or effective to start parsing what the differences are between an employee and a non-employee. Essentially, you need to make the commitment when you develop the relationship. So the hard part, to me, is not what's actually covered, as one of the panelists said, but what's not covered. The hard part for a big news organization like ours, and AFP has dealt with it a little differently than we have, is what do you do with somebody who brings you something, and you don't have a relationship with them, but you know, hey, it's really good. And that's what we grapple hardest with. That's the hardest issue for us, is do you have a blanket rule, as AFP says it does, that you don't accept anything if you haven't previously assigned it and solicited it? Or do you have a more flexible rule that says, well, if it's highly newsworthy, you have to make sort of a balance test, you have to decide whether or not to take it. So what our basic philosophy on that is, if it's hugely newsworthy, because our first obligation is to the public to be witness to what's going on in the world, we're likely to use it if we've authenticated it and we think it's newsworthy and true. But then our rules say, what you then do is you have to go interview that freelancer, and you have to make a sort of a forward-looking decision as to whether you want to work with that person. And I know of a recent case where we took the work, we interviewed the person, and we decided this person didn't have the professional standards, they were too closely aligned to one side or the other in a conflict, and so we made an affirmative decision not to take their work. So to me, the harder issues are kind of at the boundaries of this document. What's in the document, I think, is very doable, and we're committed to doing it.
Judith, you've been variously reporting, educating, and campaigning on the freelance safety issue for a very long time. Where do you see these documents fitting into the evolving picture, and where do we go from here, do you think?
Okay, I used to be a bureau chief and sending people to places like Rwanda and Chechnya, and I wish there had been a document like this then, from a manager's point of view, because you need to know what sort of resources you need, and you need to know how to evaluate the staff you have and what risks you should take with them. Now, that was 20 years ago. And now I'm on the other side of it. I'm a freelance reporter and writer, and I'm dealing with editors who are very much in the same position that I was in 20 years ago. They don't know the right sort of questions to ask. I think this is incredibly important, because if you can provide people information and educate them, they'll act in a more appropriate and engaged and responsible way. And I think what Marcus said before is a point I want to touch upon. We shouldn't see it as an adversarial relationship of all those exploitative employers or those irresponsible reporters. I think quite the contrary. I think it's just a lack of education. People don't know what resources are out there, and they don't know the questions to ask. So when I go on assignment, let's say to a place like Dagestan, and my editor doesn't ask me, what are your contingency plans? It's not because the editor is evil. The editor doesn't know to ask that because the editor has never been to a place like Dagestan. So I see this as a highly, highly constructive movement forward. And you know, I also want to point out that when I started out doing this stuff 30 years ago, like, your editor gave you a bottle of scotch and said, good luck. You know, and we've moved on since then. Like, we talk about trauma now. Like, in those days, people had what is now known as post-traumatic stress syndrome, and nobody knew what it was. You didn't have a name for it. Just everybody, he was fucked up. That's what you'd say. Well, now, you know, we've been educated thanks to DART. We know what trauma is, and we know to recommend certain counselors for people, or recommend, you know, maybe they take 2 weeks off. Likewise, when I started out, you didn't wear flak jackets. Nobody had a flak jacket. Nobody had a bulletproof car. That came in next. So I see this as the next stage of evolution.
And how... You've been training people for a long time. You're the only really sort of trainer on our panel tonight. How is training itself for freelancers changing when this document is going into a world of hostile environments, companies, of educational institutions, of corporations, some of whom have their own academies, like the BBC, which signed this document, has its own academy. Reuters has, and Reuters educates through its own trust as well. How is what freelancers need to know about safety changing?
Well, there's a new thinking in among certain safety educators that we should really move away from the hostile environment training. First of all, it's grotesquely expensive. It's like $5,000 a week. No freelancer can afford that, and very few employers are going to spring that kind of money. And I think there's other types of training you can do that are just as valuable, but don't involve going out into the field and having somebody throw a sack over your head. I think, you know, there's a movement now more towards how to evaluate risk and making decisions. And you don't have to go to some field somewhere to learn that. You can sit in a classroom and study case studies and look at what kind of mistakes were made and what we can learn from that. So I think there is a certain, and that's much more economical for the freelancers themselves and also for the employers who may be paying for it. And I think, you know, we have to be realistic. There's also, you know, there are different levels of different modules. You know, we're now sexual assault and setting boundaries with that is a new module. That wasn't really around 5 years ago. Cybersecurity is critical now. I think 5 years ago, very few people offered that. But, you know, I think the key, if for those of you who are freelancers, is don't look at the curriculum, look at the trainer. There are some phenomenal trainers, for instance, the person who does medical training for risk, who we also use, she's by far, I think, one of the best health emergency battlefield trainers there are. So, you know, talk to people, those of you who are freelancers or employers. Talk to your colleagues, you know, find out what really has worked and not, and then take it from there. But, you know, I would tend to move away from military-based training because they're not journalists. They don't teach you decision-making, and I think you're much better off seeking training from people who are journalists in the field who understand what the decision-making process is like.
And I think we also should acknowledge the rise of first-day training and reporters instructed in saving colleagues, risk, who Lily at least is here, yes, but also a particular evolution in journalism training. And to students in the room, I would say one of the interesting things I've learned from psychologist colleagues within the Dart Center for Journalism and Trauma works with is that training of any kind increases your overall psychological resilience and good judgment. So when you take first aid training or digital security training or crisis management training, hostile environments training, you're not only getting situation-specific skills that may save your life, you're also developing a set of instincts, responses, and capacities that will help you in all kinds of situations. It's a really multi-level thing. Rob, CPJ, you know, has been on this beat forever. Where do you see these guidelines fitting into the history of journalist protection, and where do you think it needs to go, the conversation needs to go from here?
Thank you, Bruce. Yeah, let me just paint very quickly the backdrop against this, because this movement for better guidelines has been going on for a while. We are living through the three deadliest years for journalists. So more journalists have been killed in the last 3 years than CPJ has been keeping records for, which is the last 30 years. And even 2015 has gotten off to a terrible start with 16 journalists already killed in the month of January alone. So that's the backdrop against this. We think this is an incredibly important document, but it's only a start. I think we have to be careful not to treat freelancers as a monolithic group. There are lots of different groups of freelancers. There are lots of different groups of journalists who are working around the world who aren't on full-time staff. This will serve, I hope, as a pointer to other journalist groups who don't just belong to the Frontline Freelance Register, as important as they are, for them to point to their regional associations, employers, whether it's in Pakistan or in Mexico, and say, look, here's some standards that we can work with this and maybe adapt it to our own use. So I think that's one of the very important elements.
And I should say in the last 24 hours, I at least have gotten some strong interest in these guidelines from Sri Lanka and the Philippines. I do think there's going to be global impact. But where do you think this campaign needs, if this becomes kind of a campaign to raise the floor on freelance safety, what issues, where does it need to go, strategically and else?
Well, the issue of pay has been raised, and I think that's an important element, and we can't avoid that, because I think that a lot of journalists will take care of their own security and safety if they're adequately recompensed for it. I think also, strategically, we need to look at several areas. One is training and safety, which Judith has gone on, but the other one is to prevail upon governments around the world that are killing journalists to tackle the problem of impunity. There are so many countries where journalists' lives are snuffed out for a few hundred bucks, you can get someone killed. And that is a huge issue for local journalists.
Nicole, I've saved you for last because you are the voice of the freelancer on this panel, one of the voices of freelancers. You've come into this business at a time of great risk and danger to freelancers around the world, and indeed a time of great chaos in regions like the Mideast and in our own sort of political system. How do these guidelines mean to you, first as a journalist, and then as an activist on behalf of Frontline Freelance Register and so on?
I think for me personally as a journalist, the guidelines are a really wonderful start. There's actually communication between the freelancers and the publications to which we contribute. And this is really unprecedented. It's something that in 2011, when I was strolling into Libya across the border, had just no concept of in terms of, am I going to be safe? What am I going to do? I was lucky enough to be with veteran reporters and people with Human Rights Watch who looked out for me. So that's sort of how I understood, oh yeah, there are things that I should probably adhere to. And I took it seriously enough to stick around long enough to understand, there are more and more freelancers. This is just the changing nature of the industry. But I also feel like it's easy to see, freelancers en masse and to see them as, somewhat scattered and sometimes irresponsible because of a few bad apples in the cart. But for the most part, many of us, and not just those in the Frontline Freelance Registry, want to take responsibility for our own actions and the people, especially, we work with, and the local journalists, the fixers, and people that help us and enable us to tell those stories. But I do feel, and this document is a wonderful start. It really does recognize our responsibilities as freelancers, which is absolutely necessary because we have to put it out there, and the responsibilities of the outlets that we work for. And again, I'm going to keep harping about the pay. Somehow we need to find a better model to pay the freelancers better, because that does equate how we calculate safety. If instead of hailing a cab in a kind of in a conflict zone, maybe we could actually afford hiring a full-time driver that we know and trust and will take us safely to a place and make safety calculations with us. That accounts for a lot. And obviously, we're talking a lot about trying to streamline the resources that are already available in this industry. Everybody from Reporters Without Borders to the Rory Pectoras Risk and all the other training groups and media advocacy groups, streamlining these resources to make them readily available quickly to, not just the international journalists, but the local journalists. Because sometimes, when you're new to this industry, you don't know where to turn to. I had to deal with a lot kind of psychologically from Libya and losing friends, et cetera, but you just don't know where to turn. And I think that having a streamlined set of resources is really essential as well to enabling.
Let me push you in kind of the freelance equivalent of the way I pushed Steve. I know for a lot of people in this room, there has been real concern at the number of very inexperienced, untrained freelancers, and in some cases more worthless than freelancers, who have put themselves and colleagues at risk. It's relatively easy to talk about these important principles here in New York City and the safety of Columbia University. It's another thing when you are in Beirut or Istanbul or Donetsk, sitting around the bar, sitting around the table with a bunch of colleagues, some of whom may be responsible and well-trained, some of whom may not. Where do these guidelines and the broader campaign of which this is a part, how do we address that problem? Maybe where do organizations like Frontline Freelance fit in, but where do you as a journalist activist fit into that? Because it's not easy. Well, to raise the floor on safety, and either by pulling these out of your pocket or
through it would be so unromantic.
Right, the broader campaign of which this is a part. How are we going to address this?
I really think, and Vaughan addressed this earlier, freelancers do talk to each other. It's so much easier for us to communicate with each other. FFR is just one of representation of many freelancers out there, but we do encourage each other, and by word of mouth talk about different groups and funding for training, etc., and encouraging each other to adhere to those codes. And obviously there will be people who go off and do their own thing, But that's what we as FFR are trying to do, address the issues of international journalists first, which is, you know, it's just trying to get everybody together in one room to basically say, we, as you know, a group of freelancers have to adhere to these code of conducts or else we're not going to be taken seriously. But as I think, I don't know, an advocate for the freelancers, I would probably have to say that, you know, this is, there's always going to be a few bad apples, and we hope that that can try to be addressed. But I think this is a start, and for us to be able to say, you know, we need training, we need to have better standards. That's how we're going to operate, and that's how the news organizations are going to take us seriously.
And let me ask you just one last thing, because you're a photographer. We've heard several times that not all freelancers are the same. Photographers are a particular tribe. What do you think the safety issues connected to photography and the sort of the baseline issues are connected to photographers that may differ a bit from people who are typing on a keyboard or doing other sorts of journalism these days? Not that we are, everybody's doing everything, but you are principally a photographer.
Yeah, I mean, if we want to talk about really the being on the front lines, I would say that the photographers often get the closest, you know, because we have to be there to get that bang-bang picture or, you know, a very intimate, close image to make that connection to the outside world who are viewing our images. I think, obviously, inherently, we put ourselves at more danger as visual journalists do, video or photography. I'm not sure I understand your question.
Well, maybe it's something for the room to think about. I think there are, as Rob and others said, there are these distinct constituencies within freelancing.
Yeah.
And I think the guidelines only begin to scratch the surface. I would like to go to a conversation with the room. I'm sure there are many folks with questions. And maybe if the other panelists could also kind of come up, because I don't know who's going to field things. And Kelly will have the mic, and the first hand to go up was in the back of the room. So, blue scarf in the back of the room.
Blue scarf. Actually, I think my name's Rebecca. I kind of know what you were getting at. So I'm actually a freelance writer, and I think I met you one time before, Nicole. And I'm actually transitioning from writing, I was a stringer for the Times for a number of years, to photography. And I had a story in the Times from the Middle East last year, which I got writing, and it really got me kind of interested in wanting to pursue photography. But I don't have that experience, so I have the experience of the writing and kind of like, you know, understanding what that means, but, you know, for me to now get clips from photography from that region, you know, no one's gonna hire me, even if with my writing credits as a photographer. So I'm kind of like, well, how do I get into doing photography, you know, without someone backing me, but needing those images to, you know what I mean? It's like the chicken or the egg type of situation. So I'm thinking of moving, I'm probably gonna move to either Beirut or Gaziantep in July. So what would you recommend for me to do prior to, you know?
I can't speak for like career advice because everybody has their own path. But mm-hmm. I'm going to say in terms of training, if you are going to be working in a conflict zone or near a conflict zone, just the most essential thing that I've learned over the past 4 years is to get medical training. And you know, that is something you can do through the Red Cross, local, whatever, not even from the organization, the journalist training organizations, but just the first aid is really the most essential thing. And that's the best advice I can give you. Because if you really want people to, or publications to take you seriously or have, you know, that credential, knowing what you're doing and the lay of the land, that's really important.
Can I jump in and say also...
Grab a mic, maybe.
It's not... I just want to say, if you're just starting out and you're looking to really get that first experience where you don't go to a conflict zone. Like, consciously, don't go there. Not only because of the safety factor, but there are a lot of great stories to be told around the world. And there are places where you can hone your craft without having to worry about first aid, without having to worry about these incredibly complex risk analyses that we need to do in places like Yemen, many times Gaza, often Beirut, particularly if you're going to be commuting anywhere near Syria or Iraq, I would say don't go there. I think the landscape's changed.
Let's. I don't want to get into a kind of a complicated career discussion. I think folks can talk afterwards.
And we'll
be
around after.
And actually, I want to put someone on the spot for a minute, which is Ron Haviv. I want to put you on the spot for a minute. And yeah, just Ron Haviv works with the wonderful photo agency Seven, and a few people tonight talked about concerns that Seven may have had about these guidelines. I'm wondering how you're thinking about it as someone who spent a career as a photojournalist and.
Well, I think, Vaughan quoted basically Gary Knight and myself, who are co-founders of Seven, felt about this paper, which was that while incredibly well-intentioned and I'm sure incredibly difficult to deal with all these different people, it's a little bit, and I'll use Gary's analogy, it's sort of like the difference between saying you should wear your seatbelt or you have to wear your seatbelt. And when you say you have to wear your seatbelt, lives are saved. When you say you should, it can work or it can't work. And so I think that for me, hopefully going forward, I'm a really big believer in using this opportunity for education. And I think that is really probably the biggest impact that this can have is by going and educating the journalists that are working today, and more importantly, coming to Columbia and other schools around the world and educating them with hostile environment education, with first aid education, and at some point, hopefully in the next 10 years, you'll get to a new generation of journalists who will start out being much more prepared. I've been a prisoner 3 times, and all in the beginning of my career, and all the mistakes I made were baptism by fire, and I'm very lucky to be alive and sitting here today. I took my first hostile environment class 5 years into my career. And after taking that class, it became incredibly evident for things that I already hadn't learned in the field, but also about how stupid I was in the field. And it's such an amazing and important thing for anybody to do before they enter, not even now a conflict zone. It is so dangerous for all of us out there, where you get kidnapped in Turkey or whatever. So it's incredibly important for all of us to be aware and educated. And I think that I would prefer, and I would like to find some way for the organizations, and I know that AP does this, to basically don't work with anybody unless they basically have gone through these classes. And to make this almost like a license to practice, something in between. And I think if we can do that, then a lot of people's lives will be saved.
Okay, thanks. Thoughts? Anyone on the panel on that?
Can I be honest?
I think, just as you're saying, Ron, how this is the beginning, I think we might end up there. I mean, my hope is that we do end up there. I think we couldn't, with this first document, I mean, you think it took a long time to get it signed now, with the shoulds in it, with the wills in it, all the lawyers of all these organizations would have said no, probably. We don't control this document. We are not committing to this in a legal binding way. But what I hope is this is the beginning where this network can be formed, where we will have the wills in the document, and we will have the enforcement in the document. That's where I hope we end up.
Me too.
Okay. Yeah. Go. Yeah.
Well, I haven't read this document, so I don't know that I agree to it or not agree to it.
Right,
but
yeah.
My name is Randy Jenner. I am an international journalist. I'm smart enough not to go to Libya and Yemen and all those places, but I'm also smart enough to find conflict in places where. The media, especially the mainstream media, doesn't put its finger on, which is why I've gotten this far. So I guess what I'm asking is, one, what about, does this registry code or list of deal with cultural diplomacy, people who don't deal with war, but deal with issues of religion, relationship between people, and how art and entertainment is reflected through that, to offer a kind of richer picture of the world beyond that Yemen's in civil war, it's hell in Israel and Palestine, that kind of one-dimensional picture.
I'll try and address that for you. Part of the problem we have is
there are so many different groups. You can divide up these groups. I mean, freelancers who cover conflict are a particular group with particular needs. We've been discussing local journalists. They're a particular group with particular needs. Obviously, you know, you can divide them up and infinitesimally. The problem is, you can't really do documents like these that covers enough people. And you have to do different documents for the different groups. And it's working out how to do that is part of the problem we face. I mean, I would suggest it's very hard, for example, to deal with local journalists in the same breath as you're dealing with international freelancers covering conflict, because their situation is just too different to really merge together in one document.
I will say, Randy, never go. No.
Well, except that, you know, a lot of international freelancers depend on local journalists, as do international staffers. So I do think that there's a spectrum of work there, but the one, and Vaughan's right, it's, you can't cover everything in one document. But I think we do also try to flag a little bit that, you know, it's sensible to assess the situation that you're going into. You know, it doesn't have to be a conflict or an Ebola zone for you to actually think before you go and try to learn as much about the circumstances that you're likely to face, the kind of behavior that you should adopt to be as effective as you can in getting people to talk to you, for example.
Yeah, and I will also say, Randy, that those that in the drafting and redrafting of this, we did try to include language that addressed dangerous assignments rather than simply war. And dangerous assignments can include, you know, culturally hazardous situations. So there's more work to be done, probably, but we were mindful of needing to broaden this out beyond bang bang war and beyond huge natural disasters to dangerous assignments in various dimensions. Other questions?
So
let me see, you have the mic. Hold on. Kelly, why don't you? Okay, yeah, do that, Kelly, and then the gentleman in the back.
Hi, my name is Anna Therese Day, and I'm an FFR member. So I think what's most exciting about this is the opportunity for accountability. So I just wanted to talk about one of the elements of, as far as expenses and expenses and paying on time. In any other industry, this, we wouldn't even have to say this, it's actually an exception to the rule that we're always fighting for this in our industry. So I guess seeing that it should happen, this is something that should have happened yesterday. So my question is, moving forward, what are you doing tomorrow? Because this is an issue of life and death for our colleagues. We've lost a lot. So what's the next step? While we have you here, I really would like to hear from different people on this panel. Do you go talk to your managing editor? Like, what happens next?
Hey, Charlie, you chaired that meeting. Why don't you talk about one kind of what happens next? And then
I'll try to do it separate from my notes. But one of the next steps.
Give that man a mic.
I'm going to try to be brief because I've already been told I'm talking too much. So I want to say that very quickly, the next step is to enlist more people. The next step is to say, you need to get into this. You need to be part of this. No one's been invited to this little table. Everyone's claimed their place at the table. And I think if you want to get involved, you should definitely be talking to us. If you have a news organization that you represent, David Rohde has volunteered to be the contact person. This gentleman, his email is on the press release. We are building a task group, and that's what Bruce is referring to. We met at 3:30. We're widening the circle. If you want to get involved with that, you need to get in the email chains, and you need to do that. If you want to give me your card, I will be sure you get on the email. That's the biggest next step. Who asked the question? That is the biggest next step, is to bring more people into the process. No one's excluded. This document isn't perfect. We keep saying this. It's just the start. But if we don't start somewhere, we're not going to get down the road. So that's that. I think on some of the practical issues, of really important issues of pay and of how news organizations conduct themselves, the start here is to be morally bound to trying to live up to that standard. Now, yeah, it could be like, you know, should you put on your seatbelt or must you put on, I don't know, wear your seatbelt. Like, be good at this, be part of this community, you know? That's what it's about. There's never been a law that mandates you to put on your seatbelt, except until they said, if you don't do it, you're gonna get a speeding ticket or you're gonna get a traffic violation if you don't wear it. This document, I think, is the equivalent to that traffic violation. You wanna be a responsible news organization, get in this community, help shape it, and help take the document forward. And I think that's the key. More people involved. That's the next step.
Steve or John or David, within agencies, what are next steps?
Well, by the way, I'd like to introduce Santiago Lyon, who's our director of photography, and who's very involved in all of these issues. And he and I were having a conversation this afternoon about some of the practical things we might want to do within AP, looking again at our standard freelance contracts, making sure we have the right language in there, and just being very mindful of some of the issues that have been raised about the pay and the insurance and so on. I don't know, Santi, anything you want to add?
I think you covered it.
Also, we're all trying to come up with a system of governance for this. So that's the discussion now with the task group.
Yep.
And that's what I mean by become part of this. As we formulate that, and our goal is to have that formulated by April 23rd, when there's another meeting in Washington, D.C., at the National Press Club. And if you're interested, and we want you to be interested, and you want to be part of shaping it, that's the next step, system of governance.
Steve, and then Vaughan, and then another question.
I want to come back for a moment to what Rob said about impunity, because actually I think it's hugely relevant to this. If every news organization and every freelance group signed this document and accepted must instead of should, we'd still be nowhere near where we need to be, because there's been a dramatic change, I think, in the willingness of the global community to accept the right of countries to repress journalists. And I think that has something to do with globalization. It has something to do with the notion that nobody wants to kind of bother anybody else because of multinational business. And also, I think big organizations like the World Trade Organization, the World Economic Forum, don't take this on. So although I'm always loath to think that news organizations should be advocates, nonetheless, I actually think our biggest safety issue is the fact that the goal of freedom of expression is now no longer widely held or advocated even by the so-called good guys, and they're not prepared to go after people who limit it. And it's governments who are still the most dangerous, despite the fact that you have terrorism. So I'd love to see an organization like this expand beyond just talking among ourselves and find a way to have much more of an influence on governments.
Okay. Vaughan, and then the gentleman in the back who had the burning question.
The one quite useful initiative, next week I'm having a meeting with some safety trainers, five or six of them, and we're going to come up with a syllabus that we're going to put forward. So what we are working with that is something that will get done, I'm confident that it'll succeed and we'll have something by spring, maybe summer, is a relatively university standard recognized courses, so that we can get courses that are then recognized, because at the moment, as freelancers know, you can do the BBC course, you can do the CNN course, and it doesn't mean if you've got CNN, why you work for BBC, because you then have to do the BBC one as well, and so, which is obviously lunatic. So there is some progress that we made on that side, which will, I think, reduce the cost of training industry-wide, actually. So it'll, we'll perhaps be serving the industry as freelancers, after all, in different ways. however, I believe that what we have to do as freelancers is make the moral case very clearly, because journalists consider themselves to be upright people, and I think most of them don't really know what's going on. They don't really know how bad is out there. Quite a lot of the people in this room who are working for news organizations, their news organizations behave better than a lot of the others. They don't know. They don't really understand. I think we have to communicate, and I think we will make a difference if we can make people understand what's really going on.
While the mic makes its way to the back of the room, I also did want to recognize David Milken from AFP, who's here. AFP, like Reuters and like the AP, Agence France-Presse took the leadership in signing early onto this document and participating in the drafting. And we need to recognize all, at this point, 28 news organizations that you see, most of which you see on the back of that call. It's a huge leadership thing. So, sir.
I celebrate the initiative across the board. I am concerned about the vetting process, only because I think so many of these organizations have depended upon freelancers for the longest time, and obviously you guys are moving in a direction to ensure that they will be well taken care of before they go into the field. But that is a vast enterprise, which I have not heard tonight. Is everybody galvanizing in these training camps and boot camps before they go out to the world? Because frankly, I think it's pretty unrealistic. And I would suggest that 40% of the people that I ever worked with were out there on their own. What was missing was the responsibility of organizations to rally around them when they were in the field. The notion that you would, in fact, ask them to have a piss test before they went out there seems a little bit staid to me. And it's just an observation, having looked at, supported, and seen a lot of people, many of them known names before they became known names. They weren't out there with support. So I may be just feeding into what we're trying to resolve. But the notion of controlling it seems a little bit bold. How do we then support people who are already out there?
You're right to point out the huge problems here. And the idea was to sort of have some guidelines so that, you know, outliers, whether it's a freelancer or an organization that, you know, don't operate on these guidelines, that there's pressure on them to improve that. But the broader question, the question earlier about, well, where do I go as a photographer to make my name? You know, it's not fair. You know, several of us went to Bosnia, you know, and got our break then. And it's not fair to say to the younger generation of journalists, oh, you shouldn't do this risky stuff, when virtually all of us here did that. But the reality, and I saw this in these meetings from news organizations and from freelancers, it is much more dangerous than it's ever been. It's not your fault, it's not fair to your generation, but, you know, we are being targeted in a way we've never seen before. And I think it's unrealistic to think everyone's gonna participate and do this, but I sincerely, from the freelancers, from news executives, these kidnappings, these deaths are an enormous thing. They're heartbreaking. And it's also a huge issue for not just a family, but, you know, from an organization. People are taking this seriously now, and I don't have a good answer for you, and it's not fair how the world's changed. It's not fair, as Steve said, that journalists are targeted with such impunity, but it is really dangerous out there.
Yeah, and I would just say, look, we're trying to be preemptive here. I mean, a lot of this stuff was being done before it was galvanized and crystallized around the deaths of Jim Foley and Stephen Sotloff. But it's not fair to go into these terribly dangerous situations if you're not prepared, because you're endangering other people, the people that have to come and get you out, the local journalists upon whom you depend. So you have a duty towards them to inform yourself and to prepare yourself as much as possible. None of us would say don't go.
I couldn't agree with you more.
None of us would say there should be a licensing regime that you can't go unless you have these qualifications. But to David's point, it is far more dangerous than it used to be, and the responsibility is on the individual journalist to look after him or herself.
Let me just add something to that. One of the big culture changes that I have seen just in the last couple of years is the growing, still too small, but growing financial support for freelance journalism training organizations like RISC, like what Judith does here at Columbia, like Global Journalist Security, based in Washington, D.C. There are a number of different nonprofit journalism trainers who are beginning to get the kinds of subsidies and support that would be required. I have sometimes wondered if we need to establish some sort of no-fault pool that news organizations could voluntarily tax themselves into that would support both training before and support after. Extremely hazardous and stressful assignments. The Dart Center, we deal a lot with the aftermath of difficult assignments for journalists, and with freelancers, people who don't have insurance and so on, simply getting psychological support can be an enormous challenge. So there's a big practical financial as well as structural need for this kind of education. And I think the world is changing. The question is how to move it a little faster. Let's do one more question from a part of the room we haven't heard from.
Hi, I'm Elisa Liz Munoz. I'm the director of the International Women's Media Foundation. I wanted to make you all aware of a journalism security app that the IWF is developing called ReportOut that will be available in May for download, that will help journalists implement security protocols. And it's not a standalone tool, but it is a tool that we hope will be beneficial to the journalism community. I also have a question, though, about the lack of mention of gender in this in these guidelines. We did a survey of women journalists around the world, and 20% of them have reported experiencing some kind of gender-based violence or harassment. And unfortunately, a huge part of that harassment came from within the organization. And I think that this is a missed opportunity to hold media organizations accountable to the sexual harassment and violence that women face. And I hope that that will be in the next evolution of this document. Thank you.
I didn't have anything to do with putting together the document. I think that's for the people who are drafting it. But what I was alluding to before in the training is that suddenly now, it's only been maybe the past 3 or 4 years, training organizations are beginning to look at the question of gender training. And I think there's a wide range of reasons why it's been ignored. For a long time, gender safety, harassment of women or rape or whatever was not in any of the safety guides. Now it is, finally. So I think, again, it's an evolving thing, but I think it is on the radar now. And also look at the women who've come forward in Egypt and spoken about their sexual assaults. That wouldn't have happened 10 years ago. So we're getting there. We're not there fully, but I think there really has been movement. And I think it's wonderful what you're doing, because the more people that talk about it, the more it's going to be addressed.
No, I think we're going to have to close it. But I would just say, in response to this and the other questions, that as Charlie said earlier, these guidelines are not graven in stone. They are a living document. And part of them being a living document is hearing the issues and concerns in this room. I mean, among other things, this is like a town meeting in which we are collecting questions and feedback on these guidelines to help not only perhaps amend them and evolve them, but think about where we go from here. We heard questions about cultural risk and other kinds of risk, questions of gender, and so on, questions about the accessibility of training available, all kinds of things. That's part of the conversation going forward. We can keep talking informally in the room, but I want to thank everyone on the panel. It's an incredibly courageous group of people.